Welcome to Opportunities Overseas, the European Union. The 28 countries in the Union offer a variety of business and education opportunities for Indians. But where do these specific opportunities lie? Let's find out. The relationship between the European Union and India has been growing over the years in various areas. However, the economic troubles that Europe faced in the last few years had the EU refocus. The ambassador of the European Union to India shares his view on where he sees opportunities between India and the EU and also gives an update on the economic situation in the European Union.
I think I see it improving strongly. This is what all of the forecasts show us. 2015 actually is the first year for seven, eight years that we have every single one of the 28 member states of the European Union growing according to the forecasts. So 2015 should be a good year for Europe. Now, that's not to say that all problems are solved. That's not to say that we can now lie down under the palm tree and enjoy ourselves. There's a lot of work to be done. But there is also a lot more confidence now that the main problems that we've been facing are behind us, particularly with relation to the euro, and that we now have conditions to be focusing on growth and then on employment. The European Commission has a new team in place, and with a very strong political mandate and a very strong political determination to focus on jobs and growth. And with the investment program that has been developed by the European Commission, 300 or so billion euros over the next 7 years, I think we have conditions to be quite optimistic.
What about employment? Because that's an area that determines how you look at foreign workers coming in to the European Union. If within the Union itself you have high unemployment in certain regions and movement of people to try and take on local jobs, then you're probably going to restrict overseas workers, and I mean workers from people from countries like India, IT workers, nursing staff who are looking for jobs in Europe. So do you see the employment issue as being a deciding factor on how the future of visas for people from India, especially in the work area, will go?
I think that we have to separate here the short term from the medium term or longer term. In the short term, the growth prospects are quite reasonable, but they're growth prospects in relation to the kinds of industries that we already have in place. I believe that any demographer is capable of explaining not all parts of the populations of all parts of the European Union agree with this, but any demographer is capable of explaining that Europe needs to bring in citizens or from other parts of the world in order to fulfill its economic needs over the next 20, 30, 40 years. So I see our interaction with other parts of the world as being a very important part of European growth and European development over the next few decades. Now, if one looks around the world, there are not many parts of the world that are going towards a demographic bonus period. India stands out. Africa does as well. Although African countries, not all of them speak English, they have smaller populations, they have lower levels of education. Other parts of the world, China is beginning to have, as from this year, more people leaving the job market than entering. The United States, others are, Japan certainly going through a decline. The United States is also importing people from other parts of the world. So India stands out as a country with enormous potential for Europe's demographic needs for the future. Demographic needs, professional needs for the future. And the condition, of course, is that India should be successful in its massive skills challenge. That's why I think that we have very strong vested interest in India being successful in its skilling program, because we believe that we would also be beneficiaries in the over the next 20, 30 years. Immediate questions regarding visas for IT specialists, these are the sort of things that we're also discussing in the context of the negotiations for a free trade agreement. We have every advantage in bringing in qualified people from India, from other parts of the world. There are some more demagogic politicians and some more fearful parts of the population of European Union countries who have difficulty understanding this. But it's a challenge that politicians must face up to, the challenge of explaining to their electorates that we have everything to gain from being open to the world.
The annual summit hasn't taken place since 2012. The EU-India annual summit, which was scheduled now, also has got postponed. Is this something that will be a blow to the plans that Europe and India have on at least the policy front to facilitate business, or do you think that this is a temporary delay?
I think that it's absolutely a temporary delay. We never actually had a summit scheduled. There was a lot of conversation in the press about the possibility of a summit during this month of April when Prime Minister Modi was in Europe. I believe that what we would like to see is a summit that has plenty to deliver. Now, we've got some homework to do. We've got homework to do on the trade front. We've got homework to do also on a number of other issues which we are developing a common European response to India's flagship programs. I'm talking here of, for example, Clean the Ganges, the initiatives relating to Make in India, initiatives relating to smart cities, initiatives relating to digital India. I'm working with my colleagues on developing a common European platform, because in all of these cases, India is going to need European technology, is going to need investment, and by establishing a common platform, which is what we're working on, we can make very significant contributions to these initiatives, which are transformational for India. Question of the summit, I think, is one that will arise a little bit later in the year, and it will be at a time when I think we will be able to celebrate a lot of substance.
Are you also trying to link the free trade agreement, which is under negotiation currently between India and the EU, to the summit?
No, I don't think we should be saying that we will only have a summit when there's a trade agreement. I don't agree with that at all. In fact, very often trade agreements require a political push towards the end. What I am saying is that we actually have some homework to do before we're at the point where the political push can be decisive and useful. So I would say that we're at the moment have an agreement that we need to sit down and work together. Minister Sitaraman has been quite clear about this. The Trade Commissioner in Brussels, Cecilia Malmström, has also been very clear. So we're looking for a moment. We're just working on the logistics to get them, allow them to sit down, review the situation, work out how to move forward. Once that's happened, the work goes by, the ball passes back to the technical people who will work on the details. And maybe there is a requirement for a political push a few months down the road. Maybe we can celebrate together.
What about small and medium enterprises? They are the ones who really need help. They need to build connections. They need to try and gain some local knowledge of a country before they can actually venture there. It's expensive just to go on exploratory trips. Is there any way that the EU is looking at providing Indian small and medium enterprises more information on companies in Europe that are interested in linking up with Indian companies, or assisting companies in going there and looking for business opportunities there?
Well, the European economy, the backbone of the European economy are small and medium enterprises. And you're absolutely right. It's not easy for small and medium enterprises to engage in internationalization. We face this problem very acutely here, because coming to India is a big challenge. Everybody knows that India is growing. It's scheduled to perhaps be the fastest growing country in the world over the next few years. So there's a lot of interest. But small and medium enterprises, European ones coming too. I know that you're interested also in Indian ones going to Europe, but European ones coming to India, face a number of difficulties that require a lot of time and knowledge of the local market, local conditions, appropriate partners, etc., in order to be able to overcome. And small and medium enterprises often don't have such deep pockets that they can have an office going for a year or 2 years without a business appearing. Indian companies face some similar challenges. I do believe, though, that we have an atmosphere that is very open and welcoming to foreign investment in Europe. And Indian investment is already present in quite significantly, but they are the large Indian companies that are present. I would hope that Indian companies, Indian SMEs, should reach out to Europeans in a range of areas. I think they will find a lot of receptivity there. I have to say, though, that India is growing faster than Europe. And so perhaps Indian companies should be looking to partner with European companies for work here in India, whereby Indian companies have all of the local knowledge, and European companies can bring, they can bring investment, they can bring technology. And I think that I know of quite a few very successful partnerships in that respect. But at the same time, when I say quite a few, they're very small in number compared to the potential of this enormous country.
The problem that small and medium enterprises in India face is that they have the EU on the one hand and EU regulations to look at, and then they have regulations of the various countries, and then further down, many countries have regions which give special benefits sometimes, and all this ties up into a lot of research. A lot of it is available, of course, on the internet, but it requires perhaps somebody who's an expert, a legal expert and an investment expert, to decipher for the investor or for the businessman in India. Is there any service that they could utilize at the European level or through the European Union offices to assist them in understanding these complex situations?
Yes, we can certainly assist them, and they're very welcome to enter into contact with my colleagues, with myself, my colleagues here at the European Union delegation in Delhi. I would say that we've gone very, very far down the road towards the creation of the European single market. A couple of areas where it's not quite there yet and where we're working, for example, in terms of the digital single market. But by and large, there has been an enormous effort towards harmonization. There are still some issue areas where there are local, national particularities. Tax is, of course, one such area. Tax is still in the hands of national governments. And they are higher in some places and lower in others, and different from country to country. But by and large, the conditions for operating in Europe are quite similar. And one advantage is that if you set up in country A in Europe, you can export, or you can sell your goods, I wouldn't even use the word export, in country B or C or D without any tariffs at borders and so on. So there is a free market there. We've come a long way. It's not completely there. It's good to see that India is moving in a similar direction with the GST and so on. But all of that we did 20 years ago, and we've reaped the benefits from it. So what I could say to Indian SMEs is you're most welcome to come and speak to us, tell us about your interests, and we will channel you appropriately according to where we think that we might be of most use for you.
One of the areas that Europe has been looking at with India is building the education bridge, getting more students into Europe from India, and also trying to see how educational institutions can tie up. What is happening on that front? Because even today, Britain does get many Indian students, Germany does get a fair number as well, but all the other countries get very few.
But increasing in numbers. And that's something quite interesting, because what I've seen, and we've worked towards this, but I've seen that there's a growing realization by Indian students and Indian parents of students that they can go to European countries and study in English, countries where the first language is not English. Increasingly, especially at master's level and almost exclusively at doctorate level, degrees are in English nowadays. And the result of that is that you have a completely different panorama from the one that existed 10, 15, 20 years ago. So we're seeing an increasing number as this realization is more disseminated in Indian society. We're seeing an increasing uptake of Indians coming to study in Europe, which is, I think, reasonable enough, because I don't want to mention other countries, other parts of the world, but when one compares to areas where there are excellent universities as the ones we have, one finds that in Europe it is much, much cheaper, it's half the distance, and we have a tremendous amount to offer, also including in terms of scholarships. And there we have scholarships at the European level, the Erasmus program and so on, and we've had about 3,000 Indian students going on Erasmus scholarships. We've got scholarships at a national level. We have scholarships at university level. So there are plenty of options also to be explored in terms of making the expenses more affordable. With regard to research, there we're very excited because Indian research institutions are first rate. Many of them, or India has first rate institutions. And we believe that our research and innovation has to be globalized. It has to be interacting with researchers, with their peers in all other parts of the world. India was, the third or fourth main beneficiary of the Framework Program 7, which was the big research program that finished at the end of 2013. I would like India to be an even greater beneficiary of Horizon 2020, which is the big research program that's 70 billion euros over 7 years that we have going now. And India is capable of competing on a par with our other main partners, which are the US, Japan, China, and China. Those three, I would add India to the list and say, you know, we want to see Indian institutions interacting with European institutions at the same level.